Development Bank, or ADB, was founded in the 1960s with the mission of assisting developing countries in their growth. At the time, Asia was one of the poorest regions in the world. But since then, the region has witnessed miraculous development, first in Japan, followed by the economies of the so-called four Asian tigers, namely Hong Kong, Singapore, Taiwan, and South Korea, and then the Chinese mainland. As the region transformed, so did the ADB and its relationship with the region. How have the ADB and China benefited from their engagement? How will this relationship evolve in the near future? I sat down for an exclusive interview with Takehiko Nakao, the outgoing president of ADB in the bank's headquarters in Beijing. Mr. Nakao, thank you so much for accepting our interview. Let's talk about the relationship between the Asia Development Bank, or ADB, with China over the past few decades. I understand that ADB was founded in 1966, but only 20 years later that China decided to join. So in the beginning, I could imagine it was about ADB giving loans to China for its development. But over the past few decades, how has this relationship been changing?
It's a very important question, and as you said, although ADB was established in 1966, because of the China's status in the international society, and also because it was not a member of United Nations, the membership of China was started in 1986 after China also became member of United Nations and also the World Bank and IMF. In the beginning years, the focus of our lending was industrializations and supporting important infrastructure such as Yangpu Bridge or Nampu Bridge in the Shanghai. But also we already started providing support for Zhuzhou River in Shanghai to clean up the river. So in the beginning years, it was more about the coastal regions to develop, to support the development of industries and the economy. But over years, the focus was shifted to more inclusive issues like environment and climate change, and how these days, how we can support elderly people by more efficient, more effective aged care system. Mm. Health is another issue. And also technical and vocational education training to support the poorer regions to enhance the education so that they can become richer. Yeah.
Is there any way to quantify the kind of scale or scope of the projects being that the ADB is undertaking?
Oh yes, in these 30 years, we have supported the China by about $40 billion of loan toward the end of last year, and out of which $4 billion was for lending to private sector, so investment in private sector. But the majority was to the government, and through government it went to regions and state-owned enterprises to take care of, again, the solid waste to the energy, the water cleaning and drinking waters and all other things. So it's a very large amount. And especially these recent years, we have been supporting Beijing, Hebei, Tianjin air pollution project, and we have already provide about $2 billion combining different kind of instruments, project loans, policy-based loans, and result-based loans, and so on. Yeah. So that is what we have been doing. And also we are supporting the Yangtze River ecological development with the amount of $2 billion.
So much money has been spent for 33 years by now. How are you satisfied with the socio-economical impacts that these loans have achieved?
I think so, and of course China has been developing on its own, and it is a effort by the government, effort by the people, effort by the enterprises, and this is one of very remarkable success stories of development and poverty reductions in the human history. But I think ADB has played very important roles in this development, although amount of money was not as very large compared to the very massive need of money for China, and China mobilized their own domestic resources. But what ADB made a contribution is by doing things together, like building bridges and building sophisticated highways with the important care to the residents nearby, environmental issues. So we provided the loan and supported preparations of important projects, combining finance with the knowledge. So that was important. And when I visited Shanghai 3 years ago to commemorate our relation partnership of 30 years, I was so encouraged that the Shanghai officials still regard ADB as a very important source of the knowledge work. So by doing things together, the China could learn from our experiences, which we got from work in different countries in Asia. Mm-hmm. But also, ADB could get the new ideas and new experiences working together with the China.
I want to hear a little bit more about what ADB has achieved or has learned from or benefited from with its collaboration with China. Mm. What has it really mean for the bank over the past 33 years?
Yeah, of course, through the project we could get a lot of ideas, new ideas, how to address issues of environment, how to have a good work with the communities and so on. We learn many things from the project works. But at the same time, generally speaking, we learned from China how countries can develop. There are many things that we can learn from experiences of opening up and reforms, pragmatic policies to implement things, and like special economic zones or the trade liberalizations, financial sector development. There are many things that we can learn from what China has been making.
Has China been a good client in terms of receiving loans and paying back loans and, you know, in that sense?
Of course, it's a really good borrower because it's a very high credit worthy country, and they have been repaying on their schedule, of course. And also, they used our project very well as a model for other projects on their own. So, and again, we can work, we could work together to learn each other or together. So, in that regard, China has been a very good borrower. And I want to continue to lend to China, at least for some time in the future. Although China is already more developed, but there are still so many things that we can do together, especially regarding climate change agendas and environment and other things.
That leads to my next question, which is basically a question shared by many people, especially outside of China. Mm-hmm. Now that China's per capita GDP, for instance, is about $9,000, mm-hmm. it's not the dirt poor country that it used to be. Many people are saying, why should China still be receiving loans for developmental issues? You know, China is investing increasingly outside of the country. What do you think of that?
Yeah, it is a very natural question, and there is it can be a valid question. But at the same time, if I think about it, consider it from a perspective of the leader of this bank, there are more gains by continuing lending to China, because again, we can share so many things which can be applicable to other countries. And also, we are not lending to China with the subsidy. It's not the really concessional lending. It is funding cost plus spread, which covers our administrative cost, and also the remaining spread can be used for supporting poorer countries. So there is a kind of a merit for China, because they can continue to absorb knowledge from us, but we can get ideas from the operations in China. And also, this is a good creditworthy countries, and by having China as a part of our lending portfolio, we can get a better rating. We have a AAA, but if we don't have China as a borrowing countries, we may need more equity to keep AAA. So in many regards, there is an economic sense. And also, more broadly, it's nice to have engagement between ADB and China in a very constructive way for China, ADB, and regional, Asian countries, and also the global community.
Well, we have been reading on the news, for instance, this latest report coming out of South China Morning Post. It says that the incoming president of ADB, Mr. Masatsuko Asakawa, says that ADB could phase out loans to China. What would you comment on that?
I don't know whether he really mentioned it or not, but when he was asked about the possibility of phasing out, he mentioned that we should closely consider those issues in a very general term. But I don't think there is a clear change of policies about ADB's lending to China.
Now, China is still only ranking middle, let's say, of the amount of say in terms of ADB affairs because of the amount of funds that it contributes to the ADB. The biggest is Japan, of course, then followed by United States, and China is less than half of that. Do you foresee that in the future China could be a bigger shareholder of ADB?
I don't know, because it can happen, but unless there is a capital increase, there is a need of more money, there will be no capital increase. And if there is no capital increase, there is no change of the contributions. But China already has a very large voice. It has an AIB. It is sponsored by China together with other countries. And in climate change discussions, in trade discussions, in many discussions, China already has a very large voice. And China is a part of G20 countries. And China's voice is larger than many people regard. And even if there is no larger contributions or shares in ADB, China already has a very big voice.
Mm. Well, some people, actually many people, especially in China, believe that if you look at the size of the Chinese economy or its contribution to the world's economic growth, China should have a better say. But I guess there is a different opinion here. I want to ask you about the AIIB, Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. In the beginning, when it was first set up, some people viewed it as some kind of competition to the Western-dominated World Bank or ADB. But it turned out it is not so much the case because there was a memorandum of understanding that was signed between your bank and AIIB for strengthening cooperation. That was in May 2016. Why was such an agreement, MOU, was signed, and what has been the progress of your
Yeah, there is no reason for becoming a kind of rival or hostile each other. We can cooperate, and that is essentially the important case. And Asia needs a lot of money, and AIB and ADB can complement each other. Mr. Jin wants to make AIB lean or less kind of costly, and to make it speedy. We learned from it. It is inspired ADB to be more speedy and lean and so on. So, and also we have more resources, more money, and we have more staff to prepare the project. So, we can support the preparation of the project and the implementation of the project, and the AIIB can co-finance with us. And we have already co-financed 9 projects and. 6 lending to governments of countries, including Bangladesh and so on, and also 3 for private sector operations. We co-financed, and I have met with the Mr. Jin, the president of AIB, many times, more than 10 times. And every time we have had a very good discussions, because he has a similar background like me. He's from the international side of Ministry of Finance for China, and yeah. I'm from the same side of Japanese Ministry of Finance. We share so many things in common. So he is a really nice partner to me.
Do you think there is a general misunderstanding or misperception of China's growth, China's rise? Mm-hmm. Because from the kind of voices that we've heard about AIB mm-hmm. and also through other projects such as the Belt and Road mm-hmm. or just China's ever-increasing presence, mm-hmm. Economic presence, mm-hmm. especially in different parts of the world, there seems to be a lot of questions mm-hmm. asked at least, especially when China takes a step, you mm-hmm. know, such as the AIB. How do you look at it?
Yeah, China was, in a sense, economically a smaller economy in the past. When it started opening up and reform, the scale of economy was so small, the presence was small, and it was really poor. But today, although it is still developing countries in many regards, there are so many poor people still, especially in rural areas. And in some aspects, like environmental issues and the health service and education, it's not so universal yet. So there are still many challenges. But China's growth has been supported by the more by private sectors and by people, incentivizing the people to work hard and more innovative. Mm-hmm. So in that regard, China has been successful because of these efforts, and China's presence is now much bigger than in the past. So I would say, although China is still developing countries, per capita GDP is still 1/4 of Japan or 1/5 of the United States, mm-hmm. but I hope that Chinese people should also understand China's presence in the international community is already very large. So many people already regard the China as a kind of one of two big hegemons in the world, together with the United States. The economically, financially, by the industries, technologies, and geopolitically or militarily, in those all aspects, China is regarded as a power, one of two big powers. So Chinese peoples should understand that China is already regarded that way, although there is an element of a developing country.
Let's talk a little bit about the economic, the state of the Chinese economy at this moment, because many people are saying that China's GDP growth is almost going down below the 6%. It seems that there is probably a problem of the Chinese economy sliding even further. What is your forecast?
Yeah, our forecast for this year, I mean, the ADB's forecast for China's growth this year is 6.2%. 6.2%. Next year will be 6%. But it's very natural that Chinese growth is decelerating from a 10% growth before the global financial crisis, because it's now catching up. And in the economic theory, we say convergence. So if the country become more closer to the advanced country level, it is a convergence. And convergence means that when there is a more convergence, the speed of growth will be slower. So catching up process is coming closer to the end. And also, in case of China, the labor workers population, working population is now starting shrinking. So 6%, if China can continue to grow at the pace of 6%, it means in 12 years it will double again. So 6% is not slow growth. It's a very solid growth. And China can still grow based on the service sectors on the supply side, because service sectors compared to advanced economies is like 50% instead of 70% or 75%. So it can still continue to grow on the basis of a service without using too much natural resources. And also consumption of a household can further expand. And still consumption by household is very strong, isn't it? If we look at the single people's day.
Yes.
huge, isn't it?
Yeah.
So I'm not pessimistic about the future of the Chinese economy.
And yet there has been some pessimistic sentiment among the Chinese people, either even with some economists. Mm-hmm. They're saying the Chinese economy cannot slow further, mm-hmm. otherwise there will be some kind of bad situation. And it's true, we have had the trade war between the mm-hmm. United States mm-hmm. and China, or let's say the U.S. launched mm-hmm. against China. So how do you look at the kind of measures that China has decided to implement, for instance, further opening up, further reform, further liberalizing its trade and businesses towards the outside world? Do you think they're taking the right steps?
I think so, and China should continue to keep a very free market kind of attitude, market-oriented attitude. It's not a good idea to strengthen the too much the power of our state, because China's growth, development since opening and reform was once again based on the private sector market. And by diminishing, decreasing the state sector's resource allocation by state sector. So as written in the third plenum in 2013, and it is still the idea of our Chinese government to make the market play the critical role of resource allocation. That is the good policy to continue, and also continue to open up, and because the exchange of ideas, the trade and services, those are the basis of growth in China. Although, of course, relation with the United States is difficult, because it's not just about trade issue, but it's also about rivalry about technologies, and the U.S. regards China is now advancing technologies and the many things of the United States, including research, universities, and other things are, in a sense, more used by China than Americans are using Chinese things. So there is such a feeling. So dispute will continue to but I think China can continue to be taking a more open-minded attitude and to be fair and continue to be cooperative with the neighboring countries and so on.
You spent actually almost 6 years, mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm. At the helm of this organization.
Yeah, closer to 7 years. Yeah.
Close to 7 years. Mm-hmm. What kind of changes are you most proud of?
I wanted to make ADB more knowledge-based bank, and so I promoted sector groups and thematic groups like agenda, climate change, and water, and so on. So in addition to lending, because the countries now can finance themselves by issuing bond. So unless the bank, ADB, can provide good knowledge, can combine the finance with the knowledge, expertise, the borrowing countries are not interested in borrowing from ADB anymore. So I try to make the bank more knowledge-based. And also, we combined the concession lending window with a lot of capital together with the ordinary lending operations, so that equity has increased a lot, and so that the lending capacity is now increased a lot. But when I look back to the landscape of the world in these 7 years, one of the important things is Asia has continued a solid growth, while the advanced economy has difficulties of boosting the growth or having some sound inflation rate. Mm-hmm. So Asia's presence has been already becoming larger, including China, of course. Mm-hmm. And also there was an idea that Asia is more based on, less based on the technology, more based on the labor and capital. But it is becoming more clear that Asia is becoming more innovative, including China, Korea, and some Southeast Asian countries. And India is also growing faster, and Bangladesh is growing faster. So the Asia's presence in the world is now greater than 6 years and a half ago when I became president. And the responsibility of Asian countries is greater. So I don't like the idea of an Asian century, because we have about half of our population, more than half of our world population. So it's natural that Asia, if we define Asia as from Pakistan to Japan, so it's natural that we have more than half of our GDP of the world. But it doesn't mean that this is Asian century. We should continue to make efforts to strengthen institutions, contribute to the development of science and technologies, and to be more responsible players in global issues like climate change. That's because European countries have been more influential in these 500 years, and also they produced a lot of ideas and institutions and so on. So it's not so easy, quick, that Asia can become more dominant. So we should continue to make efforts.
Do our things well.
Yeah, that's
do our
right.
job. Thank you so much, Mr. Takehiko Nakao, outgoing president of the Asia Development Bank.
Thank you very much. It was an honor. Yeah. Shin-san, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of The Point with me, Li Xin. As always, you can follow me on Facebook and Twitter using the handle The Point with LX. Download the application called CGTN to watch the show on your mobile devices, or go to YouTube and look for CGTN The Point. Thanks for watching. You've got The Point.